So tell us about the scope of content at NPR, and also maybe something about the distribution platforms.
Yeah, sure. You know, NPR is America's largest producer of audio journalism. We've been around for 50 years. We're probably best known for the number one and number two radio news magazines, Morning Edition and All Things Considered. But we produce a bunch of different radio shows, which are distributed through 264 member stations around the country. And our radio shows reach more than 24 million people each week. But you know, we're also the number one podcast producer. We have 8 of the top 20 podcasts in America. And our podcast lineup, it's over 25 different shows, including shows in news and business and kids and science and tech and culture and entertainment. And we've got daily habit podcasts like Up First and Consider This and Indicator from Planet Money. And then we also have popular weekly shows like Code Switch and How I Built This and the TED Radio Hour. And then on digital, our NPR.org website has about 20 million monthly users each month. And we also have this thing called the NPR One app, which is a really innovative way of accessing public media content. You can access live streams from all of our 264 member stations, and you can stream all of our podcasts and local station podcasts too.
You guys have had sponsors of programming for a number of years, but I was wondering if you could tell us now the opportunity for advertisers and sort of the opportunities across the various platforms.
Yeah, sure. And let me start with podcasting. You know, the podcast audience tends to be young and affluent and well-educated, and that's the way our audience is. And it's our fastest growing audience. If you look at it compared to our radio audience, our radio station broadcast audience is about 53 years old on average, but our podcast audience is in the mid to high 30s. The other thing that's interesting about podcast listeners is that they tend to be heavier users of video streaming services like Netflix, and they are lighter users of ad-supported TV. So they're really that hard-to-reach audience that advertisers are trying to reach these days. So that's why we're very excited about what we offer sponsors.
So tell us sort of how that works, you know, kind of the scenarios for advertising, you know, how sponsors, advertisers acquire media, and you know, what their expectations are and how you guys execute.
Yeah, well, we offer what we call sponsorship, which is in the public media world synonymous with what people consider traditional advertising. Sponsor messages can run in our radio programming. They can run in our podcasts. Obviously, I talked about how we have audio streams of all of our radio content available as well, which sponsors can purchase in addition to that. We also sell inventory on our NPR.org website and in our NPR One app and the NPR News app. Another thing that we offer is we call them soundscapes, which are more in-depth, I wouldn't call it branded content, but they're ways for advertisers to have us produce audio content related to what their companies are working on. Some of the interesting things that listeners might be interested about, innovations that the companies are doing. And that content runs seamlessly within our podcasts. And it really generates, I think, a way above normal engagement for advertisers.
I wanted to ask, you know, you guys have this very huge position in podcasting, which you've pioneered, but it's really taken off in a big way. You know, how do you see the success of podcasting, why it's growing so quickly, and its appeal to advertisers as an advertising medium?
Well, you know, I think podcasts are part of this growth in what I call spoken word audio. We did a study with Edison Research earlier this year on what's called spoken word audio. And you think about audio, you know, most of audio consumption is music, but spoken word is really growing dramatically. It's the fastest growing part of the audio spectrum. In fact, 3/4 of all Americans listen to spoken word each month, 43% daily, and 26% of all audio listening right now is spoken word. And it's growing, as I said, much faster than music. It's up 30% in the past 6 years, while music listening has actually been down about 6%. So we've been really a beneficiary of this amazing growth in spoken word audio. And I think that's being driven a lot by smartphone and smart speaker use. You know, people have been using these devices much more, and the share of spoken word on smartphones, for example, has tripled in the past 6 years. And I think it's because there's something really intimate and immersive about listening to spoken word audio, and it creates this unique kind of engagement, you know, between the host and the listener. And I think it's the kind of engagement that brand marketers really appreciate. And there's a recent Kantar study data came out that said that our listeners are much more attentive to the content when listening to NPR than when they are watching things like television or other kinds of media. They tend to be much less likely to be distracted when they're listening to audio, and then which speaks to the immersive nature of the content.
Michael, I wanted to talk about data and you know, the kind of data that you have available, the work you're doing with vendors, data providers, and how that affects the value efficiency of advertising, and in some cases, how it helps drive some editorial decisions.
Yeah, sure. You know, audio offers brands, I think, a unique way to build this multi-touch strategy. And we've seen 400 new clients over the last few years who were traditionally buying digital, but now are buying audio. And that's because of the innovation in targeting and data that's come to the audio space. And it's, you know, it's really been attractive to media planners at agencies. And in fact, in response to agency demand, Nielsen has recently debuted a podcast planning tool, which we're now a part of. So this data has just made it, it kind of brought the, you know, the magic of digital to a traditional medium like, you know, like audio radio. There are a lot of companies that have developed special tools which allow brands to see what percentage of their listeners who downloaded podcasts actually went on to visit their sites and which of these people ultimately bought products. So attribution is coming to the space too. So, you know, the companies like True Optic and others have just been really innovating in bringing the power of data to podcasting. On the content side, you know, the digital audio gives us really important data on how audiences are responding to our content, you know, data that we couldn't get from traditional radio broadcasts. And so we've actually built digital data dashboards that our newsroom producers and podcast producers can access to optimize the stories they tell and the content that they feature in our radio shows and podcasts.
Great. And what's next for NPR? What? How do you see the new year and sort of the roadmap of innovation, the work that you're doing personally, and where you hope the team kind of moves in the new year?
Yeah. You know, we continue to see, especially with COVID and the changing behaviors of consumers, a big shift to digital. I mean, people are not in their cars as much commuting. They're working from home, which has decreased some of our radio listening, but it's really helped drive amazing growth in our live station streams and in our podcasts. We're up 32% year over year in podcast listening. So I think we expect to see that continue as we go. And then a second thing that we're really focused on is how we diversify the audience that listens to our content. You know, America now, that this year was the first year in history that more than 50% of people under the age of 18 are non-white. And that's a huge opportunity, we think, given the content that we have that appeals to diverse audiences, and we're continuing to invest and bring new voices to our shows. In fact, you know, we have a show called Code Switch, which is a podcast all about race and culture. And, you know, I think really met the moment this year as America started to have its racial reckoning. In the podcast, we saw, you know, 300% growth in downloads and listens for that show. And we have other shows like It's Been a Minute and Throughline, Pop Culture Happy Hour, that feature young, diverse voices. And so that's going to be a big focus for us as we go into 2021. You know, the digital transformation has come a little late. You know, first it was print and then television with Netflix and streaming, and audio has been a little bit later to the party, because I think that radio is still pretty, for me, most people listen to radio in their cars, and it's still pretty easy to just flip the radio on and just do what you've always done. So you're starting to see, as people, I think, you know, the AirPod device making it so easy just to pop, you know, listen to audio wherever you are with your phone, the growth of smart speakers that now you can say, hey, you know, play something and the speaker does it. People are learning this new way to engage with audio. And so I think we're in kind of phase one now. We're seeing a lot of, you know, talk shows and traditional radio things, but I think the next wave is going to be more more sophisticated storytelling. And at some point, I think you're going to see more scripted content come to audio. Almost kind of going back to, remember the old War of the Worlds and the old, you know, CBS Radio Mystery Hour. Yeah, I think it's an exciting space to be in.